Welcome to this, our fourth Enterprising Partnerships event. It's a great pleasure to welcome you to UniSA and to what I know is going to be entertaining, informative, and I hope helps make a difference for many people's lives. My name's Tanya Munro, and I'm Deputy Vice Chancellor Research and Innovation here at UniSA, and it's wonderful seeing so many familiar faces and new faces as well. Before I introduce Professor Lorimer Moseley, I'd like to give you a little bit of a sense of why we're here. UniSA is really proud to think of ourselves as Australia's University of Enterprise because we're very passionate not only about training professionals for fulfilling, meaningful and rich employment, but also about creating knowledge through our research that has a pathway to being applied and making impact. The body and mind research concentration here at UniSA is focused on shedding light on how our brains respond and process pain. And then that allows us, that new knowledge allows us to create new treatments, particularly non-pharmacological treatments that can help millions of people who suffer from chronic pain. And that's what we'll be learning more about tonight. Lorimer was appointed as the University of South Australia's inaugural chair in physiotherapy and Professor of Clinical Neuroscience in 2011. He completed his PhD at the University of Sydney Pain Management Research Institute in 2002 and has since had research posts at the University of Queensland, the University of Sydney and Oxford University in the UK, and we're very proud to have him working here with us at UniSA. Together with David Butler, Lorimer wrote the book Explain Pain, which has been translated into six languages. And it's no exaggeration to say that Lorimer is an absolute pioneer in taking the research he does and communicating it in a way that is really meaningful to people suffering from pain. Lorimer has been awarded various prizes, including the 2012 NHMRC Marshall and Warren Award for Innovation and Potential Transformation. Please welcome Professor Lorimer Moseley.
Hi. Thank you so much for coming out on a school night. Thank you so much, YH, for joining us tonight, and Danny to speak to us, and also our panel, Lynn and Michael, and Michelle Sterling, who's on a plane from Sydney where there are storms, and hopefully we'll make it for the panel. I will start off tonight really by walking you through a journey that's culminated in this sort of event and the relationships that we're forming in South Australia to take on this problem of chronic pain, and a direction in which we are heading that we think is a really promising direction. Before I do that, one of the beautiful things about being a scientist, a professional explorer, is not being able to exclude anything from your decision making, which is why you should all look at my disclosures. The normal way to show disclosures, I always demonstrate this because the normal way is these are my disclosures. But I really want you to take note of this because whenever we do science, everything matters. And we have to work very hard to control the things that we don't want to influence what we're doing. But it's in my interest to support the things that support me. So it's important for you to understand what's in it for Lorimer when he says that. So I've got a legend here which will take you through the talk. And I'm going to start off by talking about groovy people in comfortable footwear celebrating in a how easy is this kind of way, because we think spinal pain is difficult to treat, where in actual fact some would argue that it's already been cured. And it's very easy to find people making these claims, and they tend to have very comfortable shoes, and they tend to have a very comfortable living, and their claims are really quite compelling. This one here doesn't just cure back pain, it cures back pain forever. This is the real solution to the back pain epidemic. And sensei is a word to mean teacher, so this person is clearly very authoritative. Our popular media holds this position up in the Daily Telegraph there. This was about a patient who was treated in Australia, in Sydney, with a device that's actually been around for a very long time, but it does something slightly different. who had a pain relief on average of about 3 points out of 10, and this was the claim in the Daily Telly. And The Independent, a left-wing newspaper from the UK, describing the stuff of Nobel Prizes, and I'll talk a little bit about that a little bit later on. But it's worth asking this question. So how are we going really with spinal pain? This is the Earth, and Australia, this is Australia, just to get your bearings here. And in 1990, the Global Burden of Disease study came out with a pretty intimidating statistic about spinal pain. And that was that low back pain is, at that stage, was the most burdensome non-fatal health disorder on the planet as far as years lived with disability is concerned. Neck pain there came in at number 4. So one would imagine that would have triggered a lot of good research, and there's certainly been a lot of research on back pain and neck pain that's been going on. The 2010 data are somewhat startling because things have got worse over the following 15 years and beyond. In the next 10 years to 2015, this story is the same. So we haven't fixed it yet. The true burden has stayed fairly consistent despite a lot of research to try and solve this problem. It's not just individuals who are living with disability who are suffering. The community's purse is leaking. The USA spends about as much on chronic spinal pain as it did per year on Iraq, on the Iraq War, which is a little bit disappointing because neither of them have really been overwhelming successes. The Brits, every year, they contributed to the problem of spinal pain 4 times what they were contributing to the European Union. And luckily now, they could spend about the equivalent of Brexit every year, is what they're spending on spinal pain. In Australia, the data are the same, telling the same story. In Australia, the cost of spinal pain is about the same, maybe a bit more, as the cost of diabetes plus cancer. So this is a major burden on our community purse. And this is not new news, and it's probably not new news to most of you. So why haven't we got anywhere if we've known this for a long time? This is a microscope, and a microscope is used to focus on very small things that are parts of bigger systems. For example, there was a hullabaloo made about this discovery, and this research is actually ongoing, looking at disc regeneration. So the lumbar intervertebral disc is injected with stem cells which grow disc material in vivo. This has been done in animal studies, which are reasonably encouraging. When they give the animal a ruptured or degenerated disc, it's normally a mouse, and then they inject this material, these stem cells, and the disc regrows and the disc height increases. Really exciting stuff at a very microscopic level. Sometimes they inject polymers, so artificial material. Obviously that has a different mode of action, but the animal studies have been quite good. The human studies don't work yet, and there are still, I think, 3 big randomised controlled trials underway. 2 of those have stopped collecting data and haven't published anything, so that's a disappointing development. Other people have tried to do this to the intervertebral disc. This study got a lot of press when it was released, injecting a substance called methylene blue, which is blue dye, into the intervertebral disc of people with back pain. And the results were astounding. They were the biggest effect sizes that have been seen by a randomised controlled trial in our field for a long time. A fellow called Nick Bogduck, and some of you would know of Nick Bogduck, who doesn't mince his words and doesn't jump at the opportunity to be affirming or encouraging. He used these words: astounding results, unprecedented and unrivaled, worthy of nomination for a Nobel Prize, if the results are true. So replication should be done. Well, replication has been done now, and it's no better than placebo. Unfortunately, that was exciting until the replication studies have been done. What about antibiotics? And this also caused a stir. This was a situation where, probably ill-advisedly, the research team nominated one of them to be the media spokesman who said this was worthy of a Nobel Prize. And it was about 3 days later that the media realised that the person saying it's worthy of Nobel Prize was actually one of the investigators, and that was a terrible mistake for this research team to make, actually, because there might be something in this treatment, and they have really shot themselves in the foot. This is one of the probably the most influential guidelines-based people in the UK. It says that these are promising preliminary findings, but it is too soon to start changing practice on their basis until they have been replicated. One problem that comes up, the theory of this is that when you clean your teeth and you have some gum disease, bacteria enter your bloodstream and find a way to your intervertebral disc and maintain a low-grade infection that then damages tissue. And you go on, I think, medium-dose antibiotics for 100 days is the treatment. And the results are arguably, by this group, good. By the next group, they're not good. But even if they are good, one hits a problem when one has to clean one's teeth again, because presumably we start again. And the idea of putting people on 100 days of antibiotics for back pain, that's a lot of people on a lot of antibiotics. There are some serious considerations here. The background to this is the elephant in the room. And the elephant in the room is a massive disconnect between findings of spinal pathology and spinal pain. This is a review of studies that came out a couple of years ago. And again, many of you will be familiar with this sort of message, but if I talk you through it, the average 50-year-old with no low back pain will have finding of disc degeneration. And those data, in varying levels, tell the same story for all of the things that we find on imaging. This is the elephant in the room, and this is being recognised now by the RACGP, by the Faculty of Pain Medicine, I think, by the Australian Physiotherapy Association, by the Choose Wisely campaign. Everyone is realising we're overdoing scans. They don't seem to tell us much. What we need is something that's absolutely amazing, and these effects are excellent effects. These are really powerful effect sizes. If you understand your effect size, a difference there of about -7 on this measure is massive. We would be excited about effect sizes of 1. This, on both pain and disability, is a truly excellent effect. This is a randomised controlled trial of wearing woolen underwear for low back pain. And apparently they had boys and girls sets of woolen underwear and got very exciting results, a 90% reduction in pain. You're just wearing woolen underwear. Isn't this fantastic? 65% reduction in pain. If only it was it was this good, this extraordinary. This is quite a famous quote from Marcello Truzzi. Extraordinary claims do require extraordinary proof, and it's a little bit early for you to go out and buy a set of Wonder Sauna hot pants, although they are very fashionable, and they look, you will look better, feel better, and wake up your body. I can see the people who own these because I can see there's that little lift in your shoulders. I've got them. I'll get them out. Back pain is about so much more than the back, isn't it? And we now know that. It's about the transmission systems, the danger message getting to the brain and the changes that happen in that system. Our research group has been heavily involved in what effect does it have telling people in pain about these changes? And we know that's a good thing to do. The problem is probably bigger than we even like to think it is, and that's why I'm so excited to have people like Lynn, people like Michael here tonight, to have people like Tim Semple, who's engaged wherever you are, Tim, in this space on behalf of South Australians. This is a highly complex problem. The politics of back pain are like back pain itself. Powerful and complex protective mechanisms for maintaining the equilibrium of the body politic are really maladaptive and self-defeating. And this is quite a powerful implication and why we need evenings like this. This is a large pile of pills, and not to steal too much of Danny's thunder, but this is the prescribing rates for oxycodone in the last, I think it's in the last 10 years. In Australia, according to Medicare, this is a map by the Safety and Quality in Healthcare. It's the Atlas of Healthcare. The shaded areas are opioid prescriptions. The darker the colour, the worse the situation. And you can see where on the map. Come on, South Australia. You beauty. These are data from the USA. Now, the USA is winning the world on this tragedy. It's a catastrophe in the US. But I just draw your attention to the picture on the left, or the panel on the left. On an average day in the US, an average day, 650,000 opioid prescriptions are dispensed. Nearly 4,000 people initiate non-medical use of prescription opioids. 580 people go onto heroin, and 78 people die every day related to the opioid epidemic. Australia and the USA are different, and that's important. This was a survey, this was published, I think, in The Guardian, and depending on your preference, you might be pleased or disappointed at those data. But when it comes to opioids, there's no doubt that the USA has sealed up gold and silver, but arguably we're on the podium where I think, Danny, you mentioned we might be 5 years behind. So the tsunami for us is coming potentially. This is an alarm clock. The alarm is greater because now we're getting experts around the world telling us we've got to stop doing the ineffective treatments. This is a quote from Chris Marr from the University of Sydney, probably one of the leading epidemiology of back pain experts. It would be highly innovative if people stopped providing ineffective and unnecessary care for back pain, particularly care that is also expensive, invasive, and potentially harmful. So we are part of the problem. But the key, I think, to all this is what we already know. We actually already know, it's undeniable from the published literature, that if we take a truly biopsychosocial approach to pain, and I don't mean a biopsychosocial approach to how we respond to pain, that's good. I'm saying pain itself. If we consider all the things that we have very strong data to tell us modulate pain, maintain pain, contribute to the onset of chronicity, if you like. If we do that on the back of teaching people why we know they're in pain, but we know they're not injured, or that those two things are different, that's probably the key. We know that's a good thing to do. There's systematic reviews and meta-analyses on that. And this is my, clearly I've got a conflict of interest in this slide because I used to have an earring. More compelling are the data to show that if we teach people self-management, self-recovery strategies, that's the best thing we can do. We know this. It's alarming that we've known this for some time. So this is the tap. This idea came from Marcia from Return to Work SA, who's done this. Single biggest risk factor for chronic spinal pain. Have a think about what you think that might be. Having acute spinal pain. That's the biggest risk factor for spinal pain. These are data from Nick Henschke's PhD work published in the British Medical Journal. If we had 10 people with acute spinal pain, about 4 of them will end up with chronic spinal pain. Almost 80% of them will end up with chronic or recurrent spinal pain, and 2.5 won't have an episode in the next 2 years. This is with normal primary care approach. With just a simple addition of phone-based reassurance and advice in an ongoing way for a short amount of time, the data change. And these are data out of 2 randomised controlled trials published in an obscure magazine called The Lancet. Take 10 people, 2 of them will go chronic, almost half will have a recurrent episode, and there are no data on how many are pain-free for 2 years. But this is a relatively small intervention. In actual fact, this was discovered not in RCTs, but looking at the control group in RCTs compared to primary care. So they're the groups that don't have much intervention. We know that if we're clever in how we teach people about pain in the first instance, we can reassure them. That's why these diamonds are to the left of this line in a forest plot. That just tells you it works. This is a systematic review meta-analysis from one of my PhD students. And it's fair to say now that the ducks are aligning. There are so many players in this spinal pain space, and they are coming together, possibly some more quickly than others. And this evening, some of those players are contributing to this evening, and this is the organisations they represent. There are other players, but hopefully you can get a grasp from this slide of who's got to be involved. And ultimately, I don't know if anyone's ever been to the Festival of Music. Raise your hand if you've been to the Festival of Music. For me, it was something I did in the first year of living in Adelaide, and I cried for half of it. But it was the one, if anyone went to it, where they did the It's Raining in Africa, the whatever that song is, the Rains in Africa. And the curtain came up, and my child was amongst that group of T-shirted people. And I know a lot of the people at their school can't sing. Hopeless singers. But when they started, it was spine-tinglingly effective. Goosebumps. I'm getting goosebumps now remembering it. Even if you can't sing, if we're all on the same page, we'll be really effective. And that's what we're trying to do with an evening like this, with what we're going through. I want to leave that with you. I always make sure I acknowledge my team, because I am very grateful for working with clever, kind and community-minded people. This is the Body and Mind Research concentration here, and we've got some in Sydney. And these are the people I collaborate with. The yellow ones contributed stuff that I've particularly spoken about. That's all I want to talk about. I want to move straight on to YH. I hope you can, or Danny. I want to move straight on to Danny. They're both pointing at each other. Danny, come on up. Danny doesn't have slides, so if we can blacken this. There you go. Danny Byrne, tell us about you, and then wax lyrical.
No worries. I'm on. Thanks, Lorimer. That was entertaining and informative. In that order. My name's Danny Byrne. I'm a GP, work at Happy Valley down south. I've been there for 24 years. When I first started there, people used to say, you look too young to be a doctor, and they don't say that anymore. but I'm also chair of the South Australian and Northern Territory Faculty of General Practice. So I represent about 2,000 GPs. What I'm going to be talking about just briefly is a bit of the official RACGP evidence and guidelines, but also being a GP, I just can't help throw in a few anecdotal stories and my own personal experience. I think we're all informed by our own personal experience. So, and also what I'm going to do tonight is probably bare my soul a bit. Open up about a few of the sort of tricks of the trade, perhaps. It's not being filmed, is it? Yes, it is. a few of the secrets, so I suppose you get a bit of a feel for where we're coming from. So to the average GP, I'm just going to be honest, you hear the word chronic pain and you have this, we call it a heart sink moment. So it's a very difficult area of general practice. Very rarely rewarding, can be at times, but overall you just have a bit of a no feeling. And sometimes you think the same patient is coming back to me time and time and time again, like 24 years, and I haven't been able to help them. And it probably takes 24 years for the penny to drop to think you have actually helped them, because you've just been there and you've listened. And sometimes that's all you can do. It's just the relationship you have with the patient, their family. In the ideal situation, if it's a bit of an old-fashioned general practice, like I hope mine is, you have that longitudinal relationship. It's not just episodic care. So that's my one bit of advice, and I'd probably end with the same bit of advice, would be just have a relationship with your general practitioner, a longitudinal relationship. They won't be able to cure your pain, but they'll be there for you to listen to. The other thing with patients with chronic pain, you have to realise they've still got blood pressure and cholesterol, and they still need a pap smear, bowel cancer screening, all the other stuff that should happen. And often that stuff just gets totally forgotten because everyone's just obsessed about the chronic pain. So that's my other piece of advice, is don't forget to look after your health, your general health. Okay, so what we are very concerned about is the opioid prescribing that Lorimer mentioned. So I'll go back to about the year 2000, or in the 1990s, there were these new drugs that came onto the market called long-acting morphine. So Kapanol and MS Contin were the two big brands. And basically, back then, with the launch of those drugs, we were told, no patient should live in pain. Fantastic. If you're a GP and you've got a patient who's living with a skerrick of pain, you're a bad GP because we've got these drugs. And we all fell for it, absolutely, hook, line and sinker. So we began to prescribe this stuff like lollies, to be honest. And in the beginning, it was pretty good. Yep, oh, it worked. Then you find patients needed higher doses and higher doses, and their pain wasn't being controlled. But not only that, we were giving them lots of side effects, so, constipation, which is a terrible side effect to have. But then longer term, it's only starting to become realised about the effect of osteoporosis, low testosterone in men, just the clouding of thinking, constant sweating, all these side effects. We're really realising that we've caused as much harm as good by prescribing these medications. Lorimer showed the map of Australia, and the darker the blue is the higher the prescribing. So the second highest opioid prescribing rate is in the northern suburbs of Adelaide, and the lowest is in Burnside. And I think you can make a pretty clear correlation between socioeconomic status and amount of opioid prescribing. And these drugs meant to take away the physical pain, but they don't take away the psychological pain of life and the stress of life. As a GP, the easiest thing to do is to reach for the prescription pad, or these days the computer. Actually, it's a piece of cake with computers now. You just go click, 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 prescribe. And when I first started 24 years ago, you had to handwrite. Maybe that's why we did less prescriptions then. But I don't want to go back to handwriting, although it was interesting because I used to know patients' addresses quite well, and I'd do home visits and I'd know where all the streets were in Happy Valley, but don't know them anymore. We've been definitely over-prescribing the opioids. And it's interesting to note, as I said, the highest rate is in the northern suburbs, and the one part of Adelaide that doesn't have a state-funded pain unit is the northern suburbs. So there's a pain unit in Flinders, for me, down south, there's a pain unit, Royal Adelaide, but there's no pain unit at the Lyell McEwen or in the northern suburbs. So for the GPs in the north, they don't have even that option for their patients. And we, of course, we hope that will change, and I'm sure it will. I got some figures recently from the Victorian coroner that 70% of the overdose deaths in Victoria are from prescribed medication. So the medications, the opioid medications that GPs are prescribing are leading to deaths, and that's a disaster, an epidemic, and it's happening in America big time, as Lorimer said, and it's going to happen here. The RACGP is about to launch in early 2017, hopefully in February, opioid guidelines for GPs, and these are going to spell out in black and white what the scientific evidence is, what the expectation of your Royal College, if you're a GP, is about safe prescribing of these medications, the sort of doses that are acceptable, the sort of protocols and policies you should have in place in your practice about safe prescribing of opioids. Because we're not saying never prescribe an opioid ever again. I mean, they're useful drugs when used diligently and wisely. But if your academic evidence-based college is saying, you know, this is acceptable, but and you're prescribing up here, then we've got some guidelines to give weight to our counselling of our fellow colleagues. So that'll be powerful because when you haven't got peer-related guidelines, you haven't got any rule book or signposts to guide you, it can be very hard for a young GP starting out. A lot of pressure to cure, to relieve pain. Like I said earlier, prescribing is the easy default. The other problem we have is just the Medicare system, the healthcare system. So I could prescribe tens of thousands of dollars worth of medication easily, not a problem. But the most I can do for you as far as physiotherapy, if you can't afford it yourself, and as we said, a lot of the burden is in the low socioeconomic areas, the best I can do for you is a thing called a care plan, Medicare care plan, and you'll get five physio visits per year. So I know I'll have a whole lot of patients on the 1st of January, early January. They know about the care plan. They'll come in and get it all, and the magic sum of five visits. Now, I know some of those patients might need two allied health visits, would be fine, and someone else could do with 50, but I'm not allowed to ration them out in a logical fashion. Everyone gets five. It's a very frustrating system. But that's all I've got to offer. Other than that, it's a referral into the public health system, which is overloaded. So that's about all I was going to say. But remember, at the beginning I said the best thing is a relationship with your health professional, hopefully your GP, a long-term one. Of course, worry about your chronic pain and how you're living with that. A young GP today hopefully will say to you, I can't cure your pain. If we can reduce it by 30%, we'll be doing well. But how can we help you live with your pain? How are you going to function with your pain? And also, as a GP, I'm not going to forget about the rest of you, and we'll try and maximise your health as best we can. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Danny. And I was very excited that Danny was prepared to come and join this evening, because it's very easy for us to be naive to the experience of the GP, as we are sometimes naive to the experience of the person in pain. And what I'm hearing through some of your reflections there, Danny, is serious struggles in a system, and they've got someone in front of them who is desperate. And your contribution to this, from the perspective of a working GP, but also from your influence at the RACGP level, is critical. Danny, like everyone else, has given up his time. These people are extremely busy people, and they've given up their time free for us tonight, I think. That would be disappointing, wouldn't it? Talking of very busy people, YHR, if you would please join us. I think all I have to do is click that. Is that right? Oh, there you go. Sorry, I clicked it too early. Can you start off by telling us what you have on your business card, not all of it, because it's very long, and what you do? Thanks, YH.
Excuse me, I've not deliberately put on a gravelly voice to sound attractive today, but it's just the way I woke up. But, you know, sore throat, it's only pain. What I do is I am, as you see there, neurosurgeon and spinal surgeon. I trained in the UK, I trained in Scotland. So when my voice is normal, you'll hear a much stronger accent than this. Hope you can hear me. Thanks for the microphone. I missed out on the Madonna style. But I've been in Australia since 2007. And one of the first people I met was Tim Semple. And I said, why is it that there are so many opiates prescribed? And he just said, we're a bit opiophilic. So you have a love of many other things, and they are good things to love, but maybe opiates are something we will not as much. So back pain, neck pain, that's what we're talking about. If we look at the patients that we are looking at, we've heard of socioeconomic burden. For those who retire because of a spinal problem, say 20 years earlier, it's a large sum of money that's being lost from the socioeconomic aspect and the burden to care. That final number, that's a big number. I think we all got similar sort of numbers. Essentially, it's a big number. In terms of the US military, there was a study called the Prevention of Low Back Pain. And they looked at it and they said, in terms of these healthy individuals that are coming along to do combat training as a medic, how many of you have low back pain? And they were fit, so they didn't have much back pain. But in the army and the training, it's quite a heavy toll on the back. So at some point, maybe back pain will be significant. But what they did is they decided for 16-week training, let's get some of you doing specific core type exercises, some of you doing just traditional exercise and training. And then within that group, they found that there wasn't a big major difference. But one group, they did a cluster, and they said, let's do some psychosocial education and talk to you about pain, and not to fear pain, because you're going to get pain at some point. And 2 years later, in follow-up, to see what they accessed for healthcare, they found actually there was a little bit of a difference. Those who had that single episode of psychosocial education accessed healthcare that little bit less. Now that's just like me speaking to the whole group of you and say, it's only pain, don't worry about it, you're gonna get it, and it's not going to be a disaster. I've got a picture there, we might as well use it now. This is a spine that's opened up. So as a spinal surgeon, I can operate on the spine. But out of all the people I see, it's as rare to operate, 1 in 10 or less. Very rare that I'll put metalwork in. If you've got your bearings right now, this is a spine opened up, the top, the bottom, and that's all those metal screws and rods. That's what we talk about, big fusion. Every single screw is about $1,300. So add up, it's quite a lot of money. Forgetting about the rest of healthcare. That's the kind of kit that goes with it. My patients sort of, I sometimes bump into them when I'm in Bunnings Warehouse and they get a little bit concerned. So we can, with modern technology, achieve significant correction of spines like the scoliosis picture on the left to the picture on the right. Patient a lot more metalwork in them now, but the spine is straight. That's a structural extreme that we're talking about. And put even more metalwork in people with other kinds of spinal conditions, like here, an ankylosing spondylitis, with breakages in the bone. You talk about fusion, the left is an MRI scan, the right is actual fusion taking place. This is an example which is rare. Okay, so we don't take away the message that fusion is a treatment for back pain. When you have a disc protrusion pressing on the nerve, it's quite difficult to get away from that nerve pain. Sometimes surgery is needed, sometimes not, but the important thing is to identify it and to manage it early, because nerve pain, neuropathic pain, is not an easy thing to come back from. So whichever way you turn, you're going to get into pain, but maybe you have a solution for pain. If this were the solution, we can end it now, and our collaborators and maybe some other people. So if you listen to those lyrics of Johnny Cash on Hurt, it's very significant that there's a lot of messages out there about pain, about hurt, about suffering. Pain is not just the physical pain, it's emotional pain. Pain is just not getting to get things easy or do things easier. So yes, this is the IASP definition. It's an unpleasant sensory, physical, and emotional experience. And that's the important thing. Some people, the emotional part is this big, and some people emotion parts that big. And quite rightly said by my colleagues, medications, surgery can treat part of it, but not the big emotional component. Yeah, we can do intervention, we can do non-surgical treatments, we can inject cortisone steroid, and we can help it a little bit along the way. It's not a definitive treatment. I'm not gonna talk about medications because the highlight there has already been highlighted by the team, opiates. We talk about supplements. Hands up those who take supplements here, because that's the other thing I saw when I came to Australia. Supplements are pretty big. If you can read the slide here, this is a man who presented in November of 2013, good general health. He played lots of sports, very active. But you see, he was fasting in 2013, but it was about 3 years after his initial workplace injury. He worked with patient care, and he got bad back pain. He attended physiotherapy. Now, what's very important is physiotherapy means different things to different people, and we have a great team of physiotherapists here. Lorimer, you belong to that field originally. And so you'll be able to identify with this. We have chiropractors in the audience today. Oh, you're not showing? Oh, yes, good. So this person attended every avenue that they could see to try to get better, and then their medications incremented. They had a neurosurgical opinion, and no surgery was recommended, which is fair. This is a scan. If you can see from back there, the scan shows there's a disc degenerative change at the bottom level at L5-S1. But, you know, he had fear avoidance. Every time he sneezed and coughed, he had severe pain. He would drop to the ground. He would crawl around. And he had the second sort of bad thing. He had hay fever. So eventually we decided, well, let's just change tack. Let's just look at your scan, talk about it, say surgery is not necessary. Let's try to mobilize you. Let's exercise you in a slightly different way. We addressed postural imbalance. We looked at the effects of posture. How's your backs right now? Because you've been sitting there for an hour. The kinetics of lifting, but most importantly, how does it apply to daily living? After just six sessions of talking through that and applying it to real life, he could sit, he could stand, he could cough, and he could sneeze. And then he decided he would paint his house, and he decided he would change the mattresses around, so he went a bit crazy. The fact is it's achievable in some cases, but why not in others? I was going to show you Elvis moving, and you can see it. Why is that important? A lot of your back pain actually stems from your foundation, your pelvis. We talk a lot about core, and I talked about the military core exercises, but you can work on your core as much as you want. If your foundation is not good and not in good posture, you might not be getting the greatest from your efforts. So that's a big part when we look at those with my physiotherapy team, exercise physiology team, and strength and conditioning team. That cone of economy, as we try to stand within it, is to stop us utilizing so much energy with our muscles. And when the structural aspect of the spine does not allow you to be in that cone of economy, that's when an operation might be of some value. These days we carry a lot of backpacks, but more we're all looking at our phones, and we're getting more and more of our youngsters who are developing iPhone, or maybe not Samsung 7 or whatever it is, neck, but it's certainly presenting with a lot of neck strain and pain. We lift all the time. There's lots of vector forces to talk about, but essentially, you know, it can put strain on your back. But if we look at a young kid, they can just squat down like that. How many of you can just squat down without falling over or without pain? The answer is, you know, they've not been exposed yet to the telephones. They've not been exposed to sitting down for prolonged periods or driving a vehicle, one leg shorter than the other, because you don't, you know, you don't have a clutch. And maybe it is modern living that has some impact on back pain. This is a trap bar. It's about deadlifting. And sometimes the people think that this is for Olympic athletes. But actually, every day we are deadlifting. Every time we bend down, pick something up. Every time you ride on your bicycle, if you come off the saddle, you're doing a single leg deadlift. So in our center, this is a major focus in terms of exercise, strength, and conditioning. In the end, there is no use whatever trying to help people who do not help themselves, as some entrepreneur and philanthropist said before. So we do need buy-in very early on. This disc looks pretty bad, worse than the one before. What do? You think I've got back pain? Well, they did. But it belongs to Matt, our strength and conditioning specialist. So he's pretty strong and pretty active and fit. And that's the bit when Norma said, structure and function aren't exactly equal. Well, in remembrance of David Bowie, he sang the song with change. And it's about change. And essentially what we need to bring about is this importance of bringing together, collaborating, and making, as you said, Lorimer, Comrade Lorimer, revolution. But you see, you've got a great idea. That's you, Lorimer. You come and speak to people. I want to say you're crazy. you're going to get stressed by us. And then you just say, oh, stew for a bit. You're just going to be one of the others. But hopefully all of us here are going to be a little bit more appreciative on the need for a change, for revolution. So, here's the old ones that we're frightened of. And change is stressful. It's this bottom bit that we really want to stick with. Hang in there, and maybe we'll come back up again. So I'm going to round off by saying in our center, International Spine Center, early intervention, that doesn't mean operate first day. Early intervention means get to see the patient, diagnose the problem early with a multiple discipline approach. Get the experts there early, at the beginning, maybe not the end. Center it on the patient's need. Address those gaps in care. That's where everybody here comes into it. And foster that psychology of wellness, of well-being, and sense of hope. Be timely in your diagnosis and treatment plan. And go for functional goals, what it is that you're living for. And to know that impairment itself is not the same as disability. You can live beyond that. Well, yeah, there's a lot of things there. Do you know, people know what this comes from?
HIV.
HIV, yeah. A big campaign, for those of you remembering it, well, I don't remember it because I came to Australia late on, but it had a major impact on public understanding and opinion. That's very important. Everybody knows this one. So much so that we're all vitamin D deficient now. Warning signs of a heart attack. Don't drink and drive, you only spill it. And sometimes the Motor Accident Commission just wants to be direct and blunt, that's Australian way. We know what that represents. It's November, I haven't got one, neither have the others, but it's important. So we understand public changing education. So in the International Spine Center, we want to mix the model of the surgical part, the medicine, the non-surgical, the movement, whatever way that we achieve it, and very importantly, addressing that mind and mindset. So, life beyond pain is our sort of strap line. We can't say we're going to cure it, but hopefully we can adapt and work around it. What's important for us is that we can only achieve it if we have great collaborators, take in the research and try to apply it into a clinical scenario. Because the thing though, my difficult patient is a patient that's read your book, has gone through the pain management aspect of weaning all the opiate therapies, understands all about pain, it's in the brain, but doctor has still got pain, so fix it. Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Thank you. Okay, this is our panel. I'm just going to start things off. We're very lucky to have some representation from SA Health. And Leanie, if I could start with you, would you be so kind as to introduce yourself, what it is you do with SA Health, and why might SA Health be interested in this problem? And that might sound like a silly question, but go.
Certainly. So thank you very much for the opportunity to be here this evening. So my name's Lynn Dean, and my role in the Department of Health is I'm responsible for working with all of the hospitals, the ambulance services, the community services, disability and residential aged care to, in effect, try and support patients to move through our hospital system. So quite a lot of the work that I do is help navigate patients in and out of our hospital system and try to redesign it to support them in their care. So for me, this is a really important topic because it actually fits with the conversations that we've been having around how people get in and out of our hospital system to receive the right care in the right location at the right time. And you will have heard a little bit about the big mandate of SA Health about transforming health. But the main thing for me is around the consistency of how patients receive that care. And we've already heard today a little bit about services in the south and the centre, but not necessarily in the north. And we know in this area that's a really important area to actually look at. So I know that we are doing some work along those lines.
So Lynn, how let's talk about person with chronic pain. How is it that they get into your system, into the hospital system, and how is it that you might try and get them out?
So it's a really good point, because what tends to happen at the moment is that patients go to their GP, a GP will write a referral for a patient to come to an outpatient setting, and it will depend on where the outpatient setting is located. So as we've heard already, they might go to the north, but they don't actually have a pain service. So they'll go to the north, they probably wait a while to get in to see a doctor, and the doctor will see them and say, you need specialist pain management, and I'll send you off to the Royal Adelaide or Flinders, for example. So the wait to get into those outpatient settings are too long. And
how long are they? Do you know the answer to that question?
So again, it will depend on the type of presentation and the urgency for the patient to be seen. But it definitely is. So Danny's giving you the answer. So it is a long wait. And one of the things that we want to be able to do to ensure that patients get seen much more quickly is, if we had a consistent pathway and it was clear about the interventions that the patients were receiving, the diagnostics or the assessment criteria, then it would mean that we would be able to put them into the hospital system much more quickly, and through that process then identify a treatment regime and then return them back to the GP to actually manage the patient. What tends to happen is that patients come into our hospital system and they spend years in there, and then eventually sometimes they get back to the GP. And that's the things that we would like to see.
Sure, thanks, Lynn. Danny, can I go to you on that? So you're very aware of how long these waiting lists are. So why refer then? If you know the patient's going to sit in limbo, what can the GP do?
Yep. That's a good question, but sometimes, let's be honest, you've maximised your drugs, including the opioids, to where you feel comfortable. There's also a drugs of dependence unit in SA Health that monitors our prescriptions, and often they say you can't prescribe any more to this patient unless you get a specialist tick, which I'm sure, you know, 9 times out of 10 the specialist is quite happy to give you that tick, but you have to refer them into the system. Sometimes that's actually an unnecessary referral, but the bureaucratic regulatory system is saying that I have to, so I have to. So that's not a small proportion of referrals. The pain units are full of amazing people, though, who have the skills and the experience where they can do some of the interventions, the injections into the spine or into the neck. I've got a patient, he had terrible neck pain for 7 years, and now just by getting an injection every few months at the Flinders Pain Unit, his quality of life has improved out of sight, and that's something I'm just not skilled enough to do. There are times, and also the final thing is, often all we want is just one visit with a specialist who can write back and say, I suggest you do this, 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 and this. It's a funny thing with a letter from a specialist, and you've got the patient in front of you, and say, because you can sort of say, the big bad guy said, I have to get you off this drug, and I have to try and, you know, just have someone behind the GP supporting them is that specialist opinion, or from YH. They're very powerful. Just a one-off appointment, but it can be, I'll be generous if I say months, sometimes years,
This is a challenge for the system, right? And one of the challenges then that you know, we've got a GP representation and SA Health representation. There's different funding sources for these two things. Is that correct?
That's a classic through the whole of health, that general practice, the community, we're funded by the Commonwealth, and the state health system got their own.
Funded by the state.
And the state health system is capped, you know, if we're honest about it. The finite amount of money, the Commonwealth system is uncapped, but a lot of unnecessary money gets wasted on a lot of crazy treatments and interventions and medications.
Can I bring you in, please, Michael? So can you introduce yourself and tell us why you're here, And I guess start to integrate this issue with the extra complexity of a workers' compensation context.
Sure. So my role, I'm Michael Francis, and my role is the General Manager of Insurance at Return to Work SA, which is the work injury insurance scheme here in South Australia. And so why I'm here, and just very quickly to integrate it back, is I suppose, Lorimer, you used the word complexity there. One of the issues associated with really poor outcomes that most of the people sort of here on this panel would understand, for people who have back pain or neck pain, as it were, is what we're discussing tonight, is the fact that there's a work injury insurance claim sitting at the centre of it. I know in the whole explain pain, I guess, paradigm, we talk about the dangers in me. The fact that there's a work injury claim in and around something is a pretty big danger in me that contributes towards some of the poor outcomes. In compensated and with compensated people who have these injuries, we know that en masse we get poorer outcomes. So really, why we're interested is that we understand that work injury insurance schemes have achieved poor outcomes for these people historically, and we have no interest in continuing to do what we've always done and continue to get poor outcomes, because quite apart from the really tragic life circumstances that we see, both in terms of short-term outworkings of unemployment and effectively benefit dependency, the long-term opioid dependency and all of the other, comorbid type issues that start to come almost as par for the course in some of these things, and we see people on our scheme for long periods of time, are things that we have to just do differently. And not only because of the personal aspect of it, but we see what it costs financially. There's been a lot of numbers put up tonight. I can tell you that in South Australia, in a scheme that spends now about $500 million a year on payments, 20% of that goes on back related. Okay, so that's $100 million a year in a little economy like ours, just in our work injury insurance scheme alone. So there's plenty of reason why we're interested in trying to do things differently to how we've always done them. And certainly, just really briefly, part of what we've been trying to do in more recent times is introduced a far more person-centred approach, whereby we're getting out and touching base with people much more than we historically did. Now, we don't have all the answers straight away, but simply by eyeballing people and starting to accept the fact that there are so many other issues far beyond the diagnosis that someone presents with that we need to try and tackle to try and get a better outcome, we're in a much, at least, better position to do that. Now, we don't know what the answers are, and we're looking to a lot of the people around us, and that's sure. Part of why we have the association with you, Lorimer, to try and almost equip ourselves with some better tools for our toolkit for our people to try and help get a better outcome for these people. Because if we can't get a better, focus on function and independence for people, the return to work's not going to happen.
Right.
If people are focused on the pain the whole time. So that's...
Yeah, sure. Michelle, Professor Michelle Sterling, who's had quite a painful journey, I imagine, from Brisbane. Welcome. So get you up to speed.
That will be helpful.
I don't think I will, actually. I think I'll just go straight in and ask you, can you tell us briefly what you do over at Griffith?
Yeah.
And then we've been talking mainly about back pain this evening, and
yep.
And you're right on top of the neck pain stuff. And I guess I'd be interested in your perspective of how similar the issues are for neck pain and some of the direction that you see attempts to turn off the tap of acute neck pain going towards chronic.
Sure.
And I might cut in if I can link it into other stuff. Anyway, it's yours.
Yes, so apologies, first of all. I was coming from Sydney and the storms, the plane was 2 hours late, so I've sort of missed the context, so I hope what I say is useful. So I am a physiotherapist by background, a researcher at Griffith University. We actually have an NHMRC CRE in road traffic crash injury, which focuses on non-hospitalised road traffic crash injury, which, of course, the predominant condition there is whiplash injury. So one of the challenges, I think it's similar to low back pain in a way. One of the challenges, of course, is trying to prevent the development of chronic pain. And one of the difficulties I see is that most of these people are managed in primary care. And there's a myriad of practitioners involved, so it's very complicated right from the word go. We, from our research, we think we're getting pretty good at being able to identify people that are at risk of not recovering very well, and being able to...
Can I stop you there? Can you briefly tell us on what grounds, what determines their risk? If you're pretty good at predicting it, how do you predict it?
Well, we've done a lot of predictive work over the years, and what we've managed to do then is to turn that into what we call a clinical prediction rule for prognostic outcome. Okay, and so it basically what we, you know, we've collected a variety of measures, physical and psychological. And we've developed this rule, and then we've validated it, and subsequently in the process of validating it again in New South Wales, and it's looking pretty good. So some of the factors, and what it is designed to do is be a screening tool only. So it's not to necessarily direct treatment. And the reason we wanted something pretty simple and straightforward was hopefully that GPs might use it. Physios, it's quick and easy to get practitioners to think about risk stratification, I guess. What we sort of found is that people look at the condition, or the patients all look the same, give them the same treatment. So what we found, it predicts the group that aren't going to do well is initial levels of disability and a cut score on the neck disability index, as well as a certain score on the hyperarousal symptoms, which is a subscale of PTSD, and age. Okay, so it's pretty quick. And then the contrary to that is we can pick people that are going to do pretty well based on the same sort of algorithm, lower scores on disability, a younger age, and no hyperarousal symptoms. And we've just recently launched that onto an online tool and a hard copy pad for people to be able to use in the clinic and score or online, and they can easily plug the numbers in or get the patient to fill it in. And the risk stratification goes to the practitioner.
So what do you do, Michelle, if someone comes in high risk, how are they treated differently?
Well, you know, I think what I'd like to see, and we're trying to test this in a clinical pathway of care, is that, so if it's a physio, we say, well, those people then need further assessment of, because it's a screening tool, of perhaps... their physical presentation, but also of other psychological, psychosocial factors. Okay, what we don't know then is what to do about them. What we're thinking is if we target some of those factors, that will improve outcomes. And this has sort of been done in low back pain with some effect, I guess. If it's a GP, we would suggest in the medium to high risk group that you know, some people may feel confident in managing that person. Or if they don't, because they're going to take a fair bit of time and talking to and communication, is to refer them to a physio who knows what they're doing with regards
can
to
I stop
management.
You there? Can I stop you there? Danny, how do you know that a physio who knows what they're doing from one who doesn't? On what grounds would you make that decision?
To be honest, it all comes to me. It's over the 20-odd years, you get feedback from patients about...
Right.
Who's done well, who's been a good physio. But I tell you what is really interesting now, it's, you know what, a good physio, it's one who spends half an hour with a patient and charges them a gap.
Right. Michael, you guys probably have your own metrics on how to decide who's a good physio or perhaps a good GP or even perhaps a good surgeon. How, is that right? Does return to work start to get a feel for this, and on what grounds would you be getting that feel?
We do start to get a feel for these sorts of things, and predominantly we use data, and we look at the sorts... I mean, there's a number of different ways we try to use that data more effectively over time. That includes everything from the number of treatments that are usually, used in order to help deal with certain patients. One of the problems that we had historically with our scheme for a long time was we had people with, we talk about long-term relationships with your GP, there were some pretty long-term relationships with physiotherapists going on, and all sorts of other things, but it's really about how quickly are we helping people to achieve a more functional state is what we're moving to. We used to, I mean, I know we still do tend to lapse straight back into a discussion about how quickly do we achieve a return to work, but you talk about capacity and those sorts of things and very much trying to focus more on how can we help work with those practitioners to try and make sure that their focus is on achieving something functional with that person rather than the old maintenance treatment type scenario. So,
Lynn, Does SA Health have any capacity of finding out, or maybe not the good physios, but what about the good departments? Yeah, I mean, is this relevant to the conversation in SA Health?
Yes, absolutely. The types of treatments, the number of treatments, certainly we would be looking at what is the evidence for treatment. When you're talking about allocating funds to deliver a service, you need to ensure that you're delivering a service that meets the needs of individuals. So we would want to be sure that the type of treatments that we're supporting are evidence-based and appropriate.
Sure. YH, can I bring you in there? So let's say a theme that's emerged here, I think, is from the GP's perspective, we want physios who are going to spend the time and are prepared to bill for it. Am I understanding that correctly? Yeah, from Return to Work SA is able to identify the people who, in a crude sense, might just be doing the wrong thing, and SA Health is looking at evidence guiding this. Patient comes to you and is desperate for a treatment for which you know there is no evidence, but they're desperate for it. How do you respond to that?
Well, we focus straight on the movement aspect of it. I think the underlying thing is that for back pain, normal movement as there is probably the goal. So whether it's through physiotherapy, through strength and conditioning, or any exercise therapist, if that is our aim, we re-establish something back to normality. So who's a good physiotherapist? Do you want me to name names?
No, they're good all here. You're all excellent. Well, the dodgy ones don't come.
Physiotherapists that I know are the good physiotherapists. The one in our centre, the ones at the Royal Adelaide, I can see a few of you. So essentially passive hands-on treatment, there's been the splits maybe especially in return to work and motor accident, is to say, don't have any more sessions of hands-on, go for active treatment. I think it's got to be taken in context. I think whatever treatment you have that allows a person to initiate that first return to movement is important.
That's fantastic, but I'm interested in Michelle, neck pain space, would you agree with that general rule of thumb, or would you, if I'm looking for you for confirmation here, YH, there is a point pretty early on where you say, okay, no more hands-on treatment, it's an exercise approach.
Sort of?
Such, okay. But I think if you've got hands-on treatment that goes on into the months, then we are needing to change slightly.
Is this the same story in neck?
Yeah, I guess so. So the active approach is the most evidence-based, but also I think the patients need a lot of explanation and education, and validation. So I think in some of these compensable type injuries, they're often dismissed, their condition's not validated. And that then, I think sets them, that's, real thing that we've got to be careful of, sets them on the path of, feeling hardly done by, perceived injustice, or all that sort of thing. The other thing I think with the trying to risk stratify is those that look like they're going to recover well, we should leave them alone. And that's trying to get that message out, or whether that will happen, I'm not sure, with funding models, but that they don't need a lot of treatment. And there is some evidence in whiplash injury that too much treatment from Canada can make people worse. So,
but too much treatment from anywhere else is fine.
Well, sorry, I didn't mean it to sound like that. I was trying to say the study was in Canada, so it was physios and chiros and GP visits, but the group were treated as a whole. So I think that the low risk group, we should assure, don't give them a lot of treatment, don't go on at them about how their muscles are crappy and so on and so on. And if they don't get strong muscles, they might have pain later in their life. We just stop all that. But that of course will be dependent on funding models, and why would physios offer two treatments when they can get money for eight? So that, we'll see what happens in that space. And then if they tell the patient they're only having two treatments, well, the lawyers will get in on the act as well. So it's a tricky one.
Thanks, Michelle. We did promise that we would go to the floor, and it's already 7:15. Has anyone got a burning question for anyone on the panel? In the middle here with the black shirt, and then we'll head over there. Did you see that, Elkin?
Hi, just a general question, really. I'm actually a sufferer of pain and broke my back at work 12 years ago, had spinal surgery last year, which has been very successful. But but I live on oxycodone, and as a result of pain management, I'm under a very good pain management specialist. But what answer is there when I am now trapped in a system where for me to make the next step forward really scary thought?
Yeah, thanks for that question. What a powerful question. Danny, can I go to you first on that, because the GP will probably be the first point of care for this?
Yep. Without knowing the specifics of your doses and everything, just the lowest effective dose you can be on would be my advice. And whether that's you get a 5% reduction or 50% reduction, do it incredibly slowly, do it with your GP, have a plan. I was saying earlier, it's not that we want to rid the earth of opioids, I mean, the most amazing drug that we've got, and it's just about their judicious use, there's just got to be a middle ground in there. But some of the, you know, where it's ending up in the deaths of the patients, I mean, that's what we're trying to avoid.
And what resources can the GP call? You've mentioned all of five physio, is that the wider allied health plan?
Yeah, you get five visits. If you use your five visits on podiatry, then you've got none for physio. If you use them, you know, so you get to the silly stage where, you know, someone with diabetes is having to use one on a diabetes educator, on two right. on a podiatrist, and and then they hold the other two up their sleeve just in case. It's a silly system.
What about deprescribing, Danny? Is that a conversation that GPs are having?
Yep. So there's a big movement. You probably got the gist of it earlier. The deprescribing, trying to get people off to lower medications, and it doesn't matter whether it's your heartburn medication or your pain relief medication or your Valium medication, whatever medications we're on as a generic, you know, society, we're just on too much. There's a new art of deprescribing, and there's also another movement in the world called too much medicine. I just think seeing us doctors and specialists and hospitals, it's just bad for you. Stop doing it. Keep
doing
away.
Yourself out of it.
Seriously,
out
of keep keep there. Away.
So what about, just to finish off that point before we go to another question, what could this person do tomorrow? Who should they talk to and what should they say?
I'd say your GP, but maybe you're on a perfectly safe low dose and everything's fine, but just you might want to Google or have a look at the side effects of the medication. You know the side effects. And often just a 5 or 10% reduction can make a big difference, especially in that cloudiness of thinking, memory loss, those types of things.
So it sounds like the key, that it's a theme throughout everyone's contribution here, is develop and exploit the relationship with your GP. Not a very powerful input, but maybe that's a first step for you to take. There's another question, here, and then over in the corner, and that might do us.
Working with people, as a psychologist, working with people around educating them how to minimise the chronic pain by making massive lifestyle decisions and changing their mindset, I know is really helpful, but it can be an uphill battle. I came tonight because I got really excited because I thought we were going to talk about what could we do in the acute stage to actually prevent it. And I had a client that I was seeing as a Medicare client who was not injured but had a car accident. When I did the testing 2 weeks after the accident, he had all the markers that you would predict would be a chronic pain person. Catastrophizing, high pain scores, previous trauma in this accident, I could go on. I tested them all. He is my only client that I've ever been able to do an early intervention program with. And within 3 months, his scores had normalised. He still has some pain. He still has some limitations. He has participated enthusiastically with physiotherapy, with exercise physiology. This got me started, and I thought maybe I could start looking at doing, at least a group for early interventions. And I sampled some physios and some doctors, and I have to say not one doctor showed any interest in identifying...
Don't turn everyone off here just yet, but can you get to the question?
What can we do to educate doctors, this is to you, Danny, to take more notice of early identification? There's heaps of tools around, simple tools, one at Griffith as well, where doctors could say, I think, look, I'm watching this person, their pain is not decreasing over time. What else can we do?
Okay, Danny.
Early.
Yep. No, that's a good point. It's not something I have ever pondered, actually, to involve a psychologist in the early intervention of pain. I'd like to talk to you afterwards, if that's okay.
Great. There's a question there.
Is there any evidence that acupuncture can alleviate pain?
I can respond to that if you like. Yes. That was easy. Thanks. Maybe we got time for one more. There was someone else just behind you there. And we'll go one more there, Annie, and then that will be it. Yeah.
I'm not an expert in this area. I came because of general...
Just put your, the
I
microphone
came
right
because
here.
Of general interest. Just sitting here... And you're talking about collaboration and partnerships. It's just sort of struck me that there's no patient advocates on the panel or involved in the chats. There's been a couple of comments about actual patient stuff since then, but I just wonder if you could incorporate some patient contact within
I can speak to that. So part of the wider collaborative group is definitely involving consumer groups like Pain Australia, Chronic Pain Australia. It wasn't for want of trying this evening, but I think the point that you're speaking to is a critical one that, and I think it's a theme that would come across actually in, I'm looking at each of you, actually in everyone's interaction, that the idea of patient-driven and patient-informed care is at the heart now of health and medical practice, I would say, and it's no exception in this space. But I guess I could just reassure you that the wider community and I guess the network of stakeholders absolutely needs to have consumer representation. Yeah, it's a really important point. Probably the most exciting data in the acute intervention space, and this speaks to the earlier question about what do we do with acute presentations, is drawing on Michael Nicholas Wise's study that's not quite published, and I don't want to steal his thunder, but that's an intervention where high-risk people are in the acute phase are enrolled in psych. Still, I think that you're in that space as well.
We'd find, though, that patients with the early injury, because Michael's is in the workers' compensation space, where patients may get told what they have to do a bit more, but we find that they don't want to see a psychologist, that they think if they had an acute injury, a whiplash injury, someone suggests that, they think, oh, you know, it's an injury, it's like an ankle, why don't you saying it's in my mind? And so a couple of studies we're doing is training physios to deliver early, not to people with psychopathology, but to address some of the distress and the stress associated with the injury itself. Because that's, well, at least in Queensland, that's the practitioner most commonly involved. So trying to upskill them to deal with some of these sort of early psychological factors, I guess.
We've gone well over time, actually. I apologise for that. I feel like we could keep going for a while. I want to iterate that all of our panel people are giving up their time and energies to prepare for this and to be on the spot, and I think it's a really tough space to be on the spot. So I'd like you to make sure that you give them a nice, healthy...